Dear colleagues, now let's resume our work. And it's my great pleasure to introduce to you the next speaker. It's Professor Dr. Anita Nachishun from the Latin Academy of Culture. Professor Nachishun is Professor of Cognitive Stylistics at the Department of Intercultural Communication and Foreign Languages at the Latvian Academy of Culture, and she's member of Eurofras, AIP, IAP, RAAM, and PALA. And her book, Stylistic Use of Phraseological Units in Discourse, published by John Benjamin's Publishing Company in 2010, was awarded an honorable mention at the ESSE Book Award in 2012. The floor is yours, madam.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Too loud? No, it's all right. Thank you for coming to start with, and thank you for inviting. It is my pleasure to return to my alma mater. My approach is cognitive stylistic, as you see from the title, and I believe that in cognitive stylistics, the stylistic patterns may appear verbally or else multimodally. And multimodal use is one of the modes of reflecting figurative thought and its development in discourse. My aim today is to have a closer look at the functioning of metaphor and also other stylistic patterns in conceptualization of economic and political austerity measures, of course presented in multimodal discourse, as my title goes. In political debates, we see that metaphorical concepts arise as a reflection of global, cross-language, and cross-cultural phenomena emerging in both verbal and multimodal discourse. What is multimodal discourse? The two basic terms. The definition is mine because I couldn't find any other in 2010, and I don't think any exists now. So this is a type of discourse where stylistic techniques are applied from a number of semiotic modes of expression. They may be nonverbal, that is, or verbal in the conceptualization of new meaning, but the main thing that they reveal the patterns of thought in all these semiotic representations. What is austerity? Well, it has got two meanings of late, I mean of late in this millennium. First of all, with the Great Recession, it signifies difficult economic conditions that is actually created by some kind of government measures in a desperate effort to reduce expenditure. Now let us look at already at case studies because I've got very little time. This is from Time, the cover of a magazine, which is an American weekly. And what we see here is a precipice and a boat that is trying not to fatally fall into it. And the text underneath, I've just enlarged it on the right-hand side for you to see. That is straight before a G20 summit that the global leaders need to stop the global economy going over the edge. Well, that metaphorical expressions are used in all types of official texts. This is very common for Latvian, not always so for for English, not always so for Latvian. What we have here going over the edge, it's a phraseological unit, means to get out of control. And in all these multimodal representations, we shall see that the metaphor is the main thing, but it's not alone. And I really agree with Lakoff and Turner that it's a primary tool for understanding the world, not only the world, of course, also the human being, our emotions and our states. And in this particular visual representation, it is a visual pun naturally, because we see the direct meaning of a precipice and we have the phraseological unit in the verbal text. The thinking process of people is also influenced by the political, social, and cultural processes that go on and that lie behind the specific context. In these, metaphor plays a leading role, also in austerity measures. Let us look at some more case studies from different languages. Well, you know Gates Schluke, I don't have to introduce him probably. And the line of an Atlantic herring eater is the is what is written underneath the fish, 2006 were the fat years, and then followed by the lean years, and further on what will happen really in 2010, there's a question mark, which is a semiotic element conveying the idea what future are we facing now. Well, here is a smoked Atlantic herring. It's traditional Latvian food. We know it very well. It is very often also used for Latvian common people, but this sense already is derogatory. In that case, it's a metonymy, and the metonymical structure is part for whole. It is very important not to forget metonymy when we analyze these visual representations because metonymy plays an important part. It shows our ability to think metonymically, and actually it is impossible to sustain a figurative thought without metonymy or metonymic conceptualization, as we shall see from the examples. Symbols are frequently used in these kind of visual representations because they are very often cultural representations of reality of the human mind, and we find frequent use of symbols, cultural symbols, also in economic and political debates, as we see it here. Well, this is truly international. Niels is a Danish caricaturist published in Germany, then Goethe Engerschnallen. And what we see here is a Greek Ionic column, which is a symbol for Greece, and the man who is trying to fasten a belt, to tighten it on a column, which is absolutely impossible, that's obvious, vain efforts, but that is the direct meaning of tighten the belt, but actually what is meant that the European Union pressed Greece to tighten its belt economically. It's a metaphorical phraseological unit, and of course it's again a visual pun. As soon as you portray direct and figurative meaning simultaneously, you get a visual pun automatically. And how is metonymy linked to metaphor? That's very interesting. Actually, it is by associations of contiguity, which means associations of closeness. And in this case, the metonymic structure is part for whole. The column, of course, is a metonym, a cultural metonym for Greece. When we look at other languages, and we know it in our own language, this phraseological unit exists in many languages. How come? Because it's absolutely clear when we look at these countries, it's not a matter of invasions, it's not a matter of trade or any kind of cultural links, it's something else. And it is just a cross-language, cross-cultural phenomenon because people experience and feel and reflect the reality that they see in very similar terms, and the it usually emerges from our experience, and these phraseological units, like all the rest of them, are returned in the long-term memory of the people. Here, these phraseological units are of polygenetic origin. They have originated in parallel in different languages and cultures. Now, these were austerity measures that are economic, but austerity measures may be also politically and ideologically driven. They may be deliberate to pursue certain political aims of the government. And in that case, of course, the result is blatant or flagrant lies, lack of consistency between words and deeds, misrepresentations, and what they call selective omissions. I would like to offer this for discussion. I hope you've taken in already. It is the cover of The Economist was published a week before the Sochi Olympic Games. Now, what do we see here? There's Vladimir Putin in the pose of a figure skater. Well, he loves sports, as we know. And when you look at him closely, he's a tall man here. Well, that is Photoshop or image editing software, as the specialists call it, because he's not tall at all, but he has a grandiose sense of self. And this is reflected here in this visual representation. Moreover, he has got the pose of a winner. The performance is over, and if you look closely, normally winners raise their right hand. Here his left hand is raised, he's left-handed. Even this point has been taken up by the author of this visual representation. And we have, of course, the triumph of Putin. We have the roses strewn on the ice as a sign of admiration for the winner. But it is pair skating. What has happened to the partner? She has fallen and broken into ice, and it's Russia on her back. Metonymically, she stands for Russia here. And of course he doesn't care. Well, we're not surprised about that, are we? But the point is that they have both been spinning on the ice, right? They have been skating, that is the end of the spin. And the ice, if you can fall into it, obviously is thin, isn't it? And what arises in our mind is the phraseological unit, to skate on thin ice. That means to risk to be in a very dangerous position. And again, we have a case of visual pun. Well, if we sum it up, the triumph is presented in a number of ways, textually, in the pose of the winner, and also, yes, he is in the pose of a Roman emperor in profile. Well, that goes with his personality, and of course the roses are there. The conceptual metaphor is success, is up. The partner, metonymically standing for Russia, has fallen down, broken in, and the base form of the phraseological unit, to skate on thin ice, actually is not there. It's only allusion to it, allusion to the image as we see the ice, and we see that it is thin. And the conceptual metaphor, failure, is down. What kind of failure? Why does the magazine speak about failure here, presenting it so very clearly? The point is that it is being analyzed on page 7, which is the article, analytical article, that goes together with the title page, was a common technique in foreign magazines, which I seldom see in Latvia, where the visual representation is on the cover, however, the analytical reading article is some way off. But importantly, it sustains the metaphorical thought, because the sub-headline is a skater, so skating, a skater with feet of clay. Feet of clay is another phraseological unit that goes back to the Bible, to the Old Testament, the book of Daniel, and it's used to designate a very serious fault in a person of prominence or public leader. My conclusion is that figurative language reflects figurative thought. Well, that's a cognitive approach. As thought is sustainable, so is figurative language, and that is important. We have sustainability of figurative thought in all types of discourses, literature, the media, public speeches, and so on and so forth. Let's have a closer look afterwards. This is summer 2014, straight after the European Union announced sanctions, food sanctions against Russia. IR is a very good analytical Latvian magazine, and we see a matryoshka. However, a bit unusual, because usually they smile, they are happy, they are plump or round, and this is not the case. And her waistline has been squeezed almost into nothingness by a Soviet army belt. And the text goes, Putin's hunger strike, because in Moscow, there were very serious food shortages, and people spoke about hunger strike already. Here we see matryoshkas of all types. They are colorful, they are happy, they are healthy, and round. And that is a cultural symbol of Russian culture. Matryoshka also as a mother in a family with all the children and everything. The Soviet army belt, identical, and a secret photo, not by me though, of shop shelves in Moscow, soft cheeses, blue cheeses. They were all imported from the Baltic states, especially Latvia, which stopped after the sanctions. Now, political austerity is actually a term that was introduced by Putin himself. But what does he mean by it? He means pressure, censorship, control that the government exercises over everything, but especially over the media. And it's not news. This particular institute was already created in 2008. It's called supervision. Well, that's a euphemism. It's not supervision, it's censorship. And now I hope for good luck that the video works. I would like to show you a video. It goes very fast, it's very loud, and then something happens in the middle. Would you like to listen carefully and tell me what happened in the middle? It is made by Amnesty International after some attacks on the media in the Red Square that ended in many arrests and people, many of the journalists, the press were put into jail because they protested against Putin's policy. Yeah. I would like to have the next slide. Let's take separate frames. It'll be easier for you to understand because it's very fast. The song is a very famous Russian song, lyrics by Nekrasov, but it has been put here to the rhythm of Chardash. That's why it's so very fast. And we see here a pool of blood, and Matryoshka has been broken. That is the representation of the attack of Putin's forces. And now the next frame shows Matryoshka in very dark colors. Remember that all the Matryoshkas were bright. With blood on her face, a black eye, and a chain. A chain metonymically stands for prison. So many of the media were put into prison there. Darkness is metaphorical, it's a visual metaphor, and it's a semiotic mode of expression. Color is very important as a semiotic element in multimodal discourse. We need to pay attention to that. The conceptual metaphor is evil as darkness. It's nothing new. It was already in the proverb, he that does evil hates the light, existed in Old English, but it also existed in the Bible. This is from St. John's, the New Testament, St. John's Gospel. Richard Trim speaks about diachronic conceptual networking because the same figurative thought, the same conceptual metaphor has been existed and developed throughout centuries. It has remained in the living common collective memory of the people because the reality is there. Further on here is a close-up of the Matryoshka. She is not happy at all, a close-up of chains. And at this point, what happened? Do you remember? The sound disappeared. Well, Matryoshka, the press, there's a camera, a metonymic element for the press, but she has been duct taped. That means that she has no right to speak. Actually, that means that no right to speak freely the way it was in Russia those days and even now. One journalist naturally, metonymically stands for the press, who the part of the press only, who are brave enough not to agree with censorship. Sound, both sound and silence are semiotic elements. Silence may be very significant in oratory, in our speech, and also in the film. We know that very many of the Italian film directors make very good use of silence. And I believe that multimodality is extended language in use because the thought continues, we recognize it. Further on, we see that the man is wiping his hands in innocence. Well, this immediately has associations with the phraseological unit to wash one's hands in innocence. Well, he has no water, he's wiping off the blood. And that's a phraseological unit, to wash one's hands in innocence, and also has existed over centuries. It's in the collective long-term memory of the people. Now Matryoshka looks much brighter. However, there's still some blood on the face. He wipes off the last drops of blood, and Matryoshka is there, happy again. So there we are. We know that appearances are deceptive, as the case has been in Russia very, very often with their political promises. That's what Amnesty International writes here, that we should be aware what Putin is doing. We should not be misled. Another very important element of Putin's austerity measure is his information war, and trolls and trolling is a very important element. Very often trolls are presented both visually and verbally in military terms, the same as all critical material about Putin's activities, like information war, the troll army, attack to weaponize, even a new meaning has been acquired there. The point is that Putin's political thought is structured by the conceptual metaphor, politics is war. He stands for it, or he stands for war that he has exercised in the direct sense of the word in Crimea and Ukraine, but also in all his policies. And the word to weaponize means to use something as a weapon. For example, some chemical elements in war are used as a weapon. But here, starting with the 2009, a new, and also at the end of the millennium already, a new meaning of weaponize came to the fore, and to meaning to weaponize information. American analysts prove that Putin weaponizes information, also culture, like the Russian Orthodox Church, and money. We know all the money that Putin sends to Mezhd Anok, and the money that all the quite a number of the so-called Russian NGOs get for completely different purposes. And I would say that Putin does not only weaponize information, money, and culture, he weaponizes the mind. Because when you talk to people from Russia, the educated people, quite a number of younger generation are absolutely brainwashed. They believe in his ideas of a new, great Russia, that these difficulties are temporary only, that a bright future is awaiting them. This is a visual representation of Putin's troll army. The point is there are thousands and thousands of them. Of course, we know the official building, that's a big new building in St. Petersburg built for them, where they work 12 hours running for 2 days, 2 days off, 12 hours running each day. And these are poor students who can't pay for their studies, and they simply agree to send all those false messages to the world. Now here the trolls are wearing the new, the uniform of the new Russian army, the so-called New Russia, another conception, a new conception that has been introduced. Finally, we have come to conclusions. Political language can be used on the political stage very effectively and may have a stylistic effect. And we see the leading role of metaphor in all these conceptualizations, in this case of austerity measures. As we saw from the case studies, multimodal metaphor is not alone. Metaphor alone cannot produce the effect. The discourse, which the metaphorical thought is sustained, incorporates other stylistic patterns like metonymy, visual pun, allusion, euphemism, hyperbole, irony, and they form figurative networks. So I have mentioned those stylistic patterns that were in the case studies. It is creative multimodality. It is not direct representation. It shows how thought functions, thought and language. Thought is primary, both in visual and also audio representation of economic and political measures of austerity. Multimodal representations and these measures reveal also extensive use of cultural symbols. Cultural symbols play a very important part in figurative meaning construction. And I may conclude that multimodal use is a feature, a phenomenon, both that is cross-language and cross-cultural. I would like to finish with a quotation from the founding father of the American Constitution. "You can fool all the people some of the time. You can fool some of the people all the time. You cannot fool all the people all the time." There he is. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions, please? No. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. No, I'm not going to comment, don't worry. Thank you.
So I'm pleased to introduce the next speaker, Dr. Clara Sarmento, professor from Polytechnic Institute of Porto in Portugal. Dr. Sarmento is professor at the Center of Intercultural Studies at the Polytechnic Institute of Porto, Portugal, and she is director of master's program in specialized translation. She is also a recipient of the American Club of Lisbon Award for Academic Merit and of the Coimbra University Center for Social Studies Award for Young Social Scientists. She's got numerous books, chapters, articles, and conferences on Anglo-American and Portuguese literature, culture, culture and intercultural studies, and gender studies. Unfortunately, due to an unexpected conflict of diary, Professor Sarmento could not attend in person. However, we have her video presentation, which has been kindly sent by her, together with her warmest greetings to the participants of the symposium, and with her regrets that she cannot attend in person.
Good morning. Good morning, dear colleagues from the University of Latvia. Thank you so much for being there, and thank you so much for your kind invitation. Today, I'm going to talk about intercultural polyphonies against the death of multiculturalism, an essay on concepts, practices, and dialogues. Because the contemporary intercultural travel is a global journey, a circumnavigation powered by the speed of light and new technologies. But intercultural transits have always been present, from the perverse intercultural dialogue of colonialism to the current cultural heteroglossia of the internet. This is why we propose to examine the motivations, characteristics, and regulations of cultural interactions in their perpetual movement, devoid of spatial or temporal borders, in a dangerous but stimulating indefinition of limits. This reflection approaches the topic of intercultural competence and the concept of interculturalism as movement, as communication, dynamics, as encounter and synthesis between cultures, with the purpose of discussing their pragmatic consequences in academia and society. Ultimately, the objectives of this conference are as scientific as political, because the intercultural stands at the junction of knowledge and politics, according to Devin, Gajardo, and Lavanchy. We will start this reflection by discussing differences between multiculturalism and interculturalism, before proceeding to a definition of intercultural competence as the result of interdisciplinary dialectics, resorting to concepts such as hybridity, cultural translation, contact zone, emergent and absent narratives, threshold, and intersecting discursive fields. The discussion will be located within the Western European and particularly Portuguese context. The author assumes a Western-centric perspective, which is always arguable, I know, and a clear preference for Portugal-related issues due to a long experience in teaching, researching, and fieldwork in this country. Portugal is also an excellent, albeit seldom explored, case study as far as colonial and post-colonial narratives of dominance, hybridity, and intercultural contact are concerned because of its recent and contemporary history. In fact, Portugal fits within Achille Mbembe's image of interweaving logics in a continuous improvisation and negotiation, since the country is still struggling with reconstruction of its post-1974 identity as a former colonial power, once central within its own empire, though always peripheral in Europe. As a result of the endless mobilities that travel the world today, the notions of belonging and homeland have been reconceptualized in contexts of migration, deterritorialization, diaspora, virtuality, digitalization, and other features of the globalized world that make even more pertinent the principle by Stuart Hall that cultural identities are not fixed but fluid, not given but performed. In this way, we cross the first great border of intercultural transits, the frontier created by the concept of culture itself, avoiding the commonplace notion of the intercultural as a mere us versus them, and steering clear of the fundamental era of an interculturalism that ignores the diversity contained in its own definition. This approach generates an interdisciplinary dialogue between fields that have traditionally ignored each other, such as translation studies and anthropology, such as law and the sciences of language, history and literary studies, because intercultural competence entails the ability to understand the close relationship between language, culture, arts, conventions and discourse in a constant process of problem solving and anticipation, adaptation and awareness. Hence, the present approach to the notion of intercultural functions as a sort of third space, to quote from Homi Bhabha, a third space for hybridity, subversion and transgression. Hybridity and cultural translation, which Bhabha regards as a synonym for hybridity, is politically subversive. Hybridity is the space where all binary divisions and antagonisms, typical of conservative political and academic concepts, including the old opposition between theory and practice, critical reflection and politics, science and humanities, do not work anymore. They do not work in intercultural competence either, since we understand it as capacity for an unceasing movement, communication and cooperation between cultures. Present-day converging interests are evident in the expectations of both publishers and reading public, and in the relations of power that pervade Western academic life, with its tenure tracks, publish or perish mantras, rankings and indexes, and general anti-humanities trends. These notions and expectations persistently transform the output of researchers to the extent that they tend to adapt their practices and creative capabilities to professional and economic pressures. However, many of those researchers often respond to such pressures with their own strategies, innovations, and subversions, and seldom do they remain passive within the process of incorporation in large-scale political and institutional systems. Networks and echoes emanating from the international academic community spread rapidly throughout the globe, and their multiple forms of cultural interaction bring with them their own forms of manipulation and subversion of power. These actions, carried out in the peripheries, and which are, in turn, central in the lives and experiences of individuals, can be designated and described, more or less metaphorically, as border zones, thresholds, intersecting discursive fields, or spaces on the side of the road, all of them reflecting the dialogical nature of culture and intercultural competence. Therefore, intercultural competence is the place where the overlapping of cultures occurs, which is the characteristic of a site of cultural translation. Cultural translation, both as Judith Butler's Return of the Excluded and as Bhabha's hybridity, is a major force of contemporary democracy, also in the academic field. For Judith Butler, the universal, here understood as a synonym of hegemony, a Gramscian combination of power and consent, can only be conceptualized in articulation with its own peripheries, those aforementioned border zones, spaces on the side of the road, and other metaphors. Thus, what has been excluded from the concept of universality forces this same concept from the outside, from the margins, to accept and include it again, which can only happen when the concept itself has evolved enough to include its own excluded. This pressure eventually leads to the rearticulation of the current concept of universality and its power. To the process through which universality readmits its own excluded, Butler calls translation. Cultural translation may work as the return of the excluded, pushing limits, bringing about epistemological changes, and opening new spaces for free discussion and independent research. Because, for Baba, as well as for the Portuguese sociologist Boaventura de Sousa Santos, the potential for change is located at the peripheries. Peripheries marked by hybridity, where the new arrivals or excluded, like polytechnics or universities from peripheral countries, like unconventional research groups, like young female academics, are able to use subversion in order to undermine the strategies of the powerful, regardless of who they are. When talking about the intercultural experience, it is tempting to talk on behalf of the others, but seldom do we grant a voice to those others themselves. However, the true intercultural experience occurs when we are able to see ourselves and our work as if we were those so-called others, whose otherness originates, for example, from their nationality, gender, orientation, academic background, or field of research. Let us remind that Derrida has shown how the construction of an identity is always based on exclusion, and that a violent hierarchy results from such dichotomous pairs, as in the binomials man, woman, white, black, colonizer, colonized, straight, gay, elite, the masses, and nowadays also in science and technology versus arts and humanities. But local and global practices and knowledge, with their associated discursive productions, do not form a dichotomy. Instead, their correlation provides a stimulating dynamic tension as the search for local concepts generates new concepts, which encourage the challenge of epistemological and phenomenological adaptation under a genuine interdisciplinary and intercultural perspective. Any approach must be located within the network of ideological and material contexts of a given region, which is always an evolving territory. In a post-colonial world, the intersection of past and present, global and local, defined the guidelines to explore the negotiation and evolution of concepts, as well as material forces that influence individuals, communities, and nations. Post-colonial societies, either Eastern or Western, Northern or Southern, are in a continuous intercultural flow. This constant need to negotiate and construct identity through a polyphony of narratives actually underlies life in most parts of the world. The concept of interculturalism here explored and the related idea of intercultural competence also develops from polyphonic narratives of dynamic tension. This concept of interculturalism might be compared to the concept of multiculturalism, which in these pages and in this talk, we understand as a delimited space within which different cultures cohabitate in a self-enclosed, stationary ignorance. But in reality, the multicultural space exists as a result of intercultural, multidirectional, and reciprocal, perhaps random, movements, and as such, shall be discussed now. In general, multiculturalism has been analyzed under an ontological approach as an existing or desired social reality. Multiculturalism has also been widely subjected to a political ideological study, focusing both on the dominant or host society and on the migrant or allegedly minority groups. Conversely, interculturalism is analyzable as movement with an underlying stream of consciousness and manifested critically in critically aware journeys, for instance, in mutual knowledge or in the understanding and communication in general. Interculturalism is then, and preferably, a hermeneutic option, an epistemological approach, as Martin Abdallah-Pretzey emphasizes, because no fact is intercultural per se, nor is interculturalism an attribute of the object. Only intercultural analysis can give it this character through a paradigm of hybrid, segmentary, and heterogeneous thinking. Multiculturalism tends to assume a utopian character stripped of dilemmatic or conflicting aspects, as it is impossible to ignore all impending cases of conflict of norms, values, and practices. By following this argument, and bearing in mind that utopias are by definition unreal, it is tempting to jump into a shocked, disappointed conclusion at the alleged failure of multiculturalism, a conclusion that, in fact, shows that it is impossible for different cultures to coexist. Therefore, when this discourse becomes an actual practice, those who are identified as agents of difference might be segregated or ultimately erased through illegalization, deportation, imprisonment, even assassination, for the sake of common sense, so that a normal or normalized society might prevail. In fact, as we can see, there are political implications when distinguishing multiculturalism from interculturalism. The political exploitation and ideological abuse of the concept of multiculturalism can be related to the polemical speech by German Chancellor Angela Merkel, who declared the death of multiculturalism without elaborating on the nature and causes of such death. Merkel was referring to the implicit illusion that Germans and foreign workers could live side by side once lost the hope that they wouldn't stay, they being the guest workers who arrived in Germany to fill the labor shortage during the economic boom of the 60s. In Merkel's speech, the representation of these groups and their competences is underpinned by a certain shared notion of culture, multicultural, and their agents. The death of multiculturalism implies that its agents, those who have brought along multiplicity and difference, have also failed and are no longer welcome. But recent history, in Germany as elsewhere in the world, has taught us that discursive categories and symbolic markers of identity have actual and very dramatic effects in the everyday experience of groups and individuals and societies. The apparent shortcomings of multiculturalism require the transition to a more complex stage, that of intercultural competence, in the context of diversity that now characterizes Western societies. Miren Modud, for instance, state that the multicultural framework has allowed the evolution from biological racism to cultural racism, emphasizing the old dichotomy of self and other, and producing an idea of culture which is naturalistic and essentialistic through the homogenization of identities. Indeed, racism can exist without race, operating through reductionist discourses that favor the cultural explanation at the expense of other levels of analysis and approaching interactions in a monocausal way. Despite the obvious difficulty of the task, and for the sake of this argument, it is appropriate now to establish a brief diachronic perspective. The concept of interculturalism emerged in France during the 70s due to the need for inclusion of immigrant children and consequent adaptation of educational methods in the face of an increasingly multicultural society. French interculturalism is less anchored in civic rights movements and more influenced by international organizations such as UNESCO and the European Council. Schools, as a means of inclusion of different communities, were the first institutions to feel the need for intercultural competence through the practice of socio-cultural mediation. In Portugal, socio-cultural mediation emerged in the 90s as a result of the countries joining the then European Economic Community. Through it, Portugal started further contacts with countries where social-cultural mediation was already an essential institution way to achieve inclusion. Portuguese policies of social-cultural mediation are essentially performed by qualified agents of communication who promote dialogue between cultures and social groups, seeking to mitigate differences by knowing and understanding them. On the other hand, the concept of multiculturalism prevails in the Anglo-Saxon world, where groups of different cultural matrices are integrated in public life in order to ensure social cohesion, but not inclusion. Moreover, a well-integrated person is one who has become like us and thus, implicitly, will never become us. Well, ultimately, a well-integrated person has rejected or concealed those features that might be identified as foreign, thus rejecting or concealing a significant part, if not all, of her or his own identity, the stable core to one's individuality and sense of personal location. Interestingly, a significant part of the existing literature on multiculturalism in English is, in fact, an exhaustive list of differences between an individual us, shocked but full of goodwill, and a collective other, characterized as homogeneous and hypersensitive to offenses to their strange traditions. This literature takes the form of empirical manuals with very pragmatic purposes: to facilitate economic relations with exotic partners and or become popular university toolkits. Departing invariably from artificial situations of conflict, misunderstanding, lack of communication, latent hostility, and general embarrassment caused by the exposure to the cultural norms and practices of the other, seldom do the explanations provided equate even the possibility of a certain action being dictated by the individual's consciousness. For the authors who favor this essentialist approach a bit too much, it seems to be inconceivable that a non-Western or even a non-Anglo-Saxon person or behavior may derive from something else than the simple dictates of tradition and culture met without dissonance or place for the agency of autonomous individuals. When highlighting intergroup differences instead of intra-group and inter-individual differences, business, education, training, and communication in general become strictly culturalized. When an individual, who is seldom the prototype of a group, fails to be incorporated into the expected and prejudged framework, serious difficulties arise because, in reality, people cannot be understood outside of a process of communication and exchange. Questioning one's identity in relation to others is an integral part of intercultural competence, as the work of analysis and of acquiring knowledge applies to others as much to oneself. A statement that marks the emphasis currently placed on intercultural competence can be found on seven principle, common basic principle for immigrant integration of the European Union, which argues, very significantly, that the frequent interaction between immigrants and citizens of member states is a fundamental mechanism for inclusion, emphasizing the importance of communal forums, intercultural dialogue, and information about immigrants and their cultures. The key point here is the inverse of a mere celebration of diversity of culture as folklore or as ethnic versions of classic multiculturalism. What is involved here is the positive encouragement of actual encounters between different groups and the creation of dialogue and joint activities. Of course, this does not mean that intercultural dialogue has not been part of multicultural philosophy and practice, but it becomes evident that the idea of multiculturalism has succumbed too easily to an interpretation of ethnic cultures with strictly defined boundaries and static essential components without internal dissent. In other words, multiculturalism has been oriented towards essentialism, albeit tacitly or implicitly, as is the case of the above-cited manuals of intercultural communication. The approach to multiculturalism as folklore, where commodified cultures orderly display themselves for the comfort of dominant groups, entails a superficial and a critical understanding of cultural diversity. Maria Kromidas contrasts a multiculturalism that stresses typologies and categorizations with an interculturalism that emphasizes mutations, fusions, and relations. Again, typologies and categorizations are expressions of power, politically and historically constructed, and are by no means universal truths. Hence, the ultimate goal of multiculturalism is a cautious tolerance. While that of interculturalism is communication. Interculturalism implies the shift from an analysis in terms of structures and states to one of complex, changeable, and arbitrary situations, processes, and cultural phenomena, such as acculturation, assimilation, resistance, identity, or hybridity. In brief, culture in action instead of culture as an object. That is the aim of intercultural competence. The key skills for intercultural competence rely on interdisciplinarity and creativity in order to generate a productive intervention both in society and science. Creative interdisciplinary approaches to the intercultural phenomena are therefore likely to select unexpected fields of study with their own hybrid methodologies. This will be the core argument of the second section, as the relational and even dialectic epistemology of our perception of intercultural competence is crucial for a study that goes beyond meaningless cultural multiplicity. We use here the term dialectic because, though conflict is necessarily part of the intercultural process, both in social practice and in academic research, synthesis will hopefully emerge from it. Intercultural competence and capacity for dialogue between cultures are not a mere passive acceptance of the multicultural factor, nor the utopia of complete harmonization, but rather an essential component of every culture that wishes to assert itself as such. This type of dialogue occurs amongst individuals who speak different languages and for whom words and objects have diverse meanings. However, this does not result into a new Tower of Babel, nor into social chaos, because there is an attempt at communication, and there is something that is actually shared, which is exactly what allows awareness of and openness to difference. When differences are left aside and considered as non-existent, the result is an insufficient understanding of self and other. That is why it is necessary to understand the communicative challenge presented by the unlimited amount of discourse and text within the framework of intercultural competence. Although identity and difference are not exclusive discursive, they are contained in discourse. It is for this reason that language becomes a major factor when dealing with interculturalism. On the other hand, linguistic diversity is also present within the boundaries of a national language through interlinguistic, social, regional, and stylistic differences, as well as through variations in dialect and register, thus calling for an intercultural variety of intercultural competence. Some examples are, for instance, the Portuguese dialect Mirandês or the typical accent of Porto that can be interpreted either as marks of social background, statements of regional identity, or even as everyday forms of resistance to the cultural centralism of the capital Lisbon. The symbolic value attached to different languages or to variants of a common language has to be interpreted in conjunction with other meanings shared within social interactions, because cultural signs are polysemous and their meaning can only be provided through a contextualized analysis that goes well beyond the mere recourse to a dictionary. Communicative competence develops at the intra- and intercultural level alike. In other words, speakers need to be aware of the variety of registers and of the plurality of discourses that exist in a culture, either their own or others, following the principle of self and hetero-analysis characteristic of intercultural competence. As a prerequisite for intercultural dialogue, we must recognize the different languages used by other actors and know their hidden dimensions, even if we cannot do it otherwise than through translation, in order to assimilate the unknown culture as a variation of our own. But practices and styles of translation that are not truly interpretive may hinder rather than facilitate intercultural communication. The hegemonic power of a culture can be enhanced if we accept as natural a translation in which the voices of other cultures are domesticated without being understood as originated elsewhere. If diversity is now more visible than ever, it is also more communicable. This has gradually become obvious with the emergence of English as lingua franca in a globalized world and with growing need for translation skills by individuals and institutions alike. This is why the work of the translator acquires new dimensions. On one hand, the translator establishes relationships which make knowledge more accessible, which bring people and cultures together. On the other hand, he or she directly interferes in her or his country's textual production to the extent that recreates, according to a predetermined model, aesthetic shapes, ideologies, and epistemologies to be included in his or her own tradition. The subversive nature of translation creates a renewed vision of the figure of the translator, granting her or him an important role that was not evident before because, and quoting Lefebvre, translation is one of the most obvious forms of image making of manipulation that we have. Resistance to the impositions of globalization is marked by the way local communities preserve and transmit their oral traditions, dialects, founding myths, and precepts of common knowledge, whose cultural symbolism, ethics, and aesthetics may function as educational tools for intercultural competence. Such manifestations of memory as part of identity, both individual and collective, are also a key factor for the essential sense of continuity, coherence, and reconstruction of communities. For the present study, the main relevance of narratives of local and oral culture does not lie in their credibility as documents in the positivist sense, because, and according to Sidney Chaloup on literary fiction, they search for reality, interpret, and tell true stories about society, but do not have to function as a glass window over or as a mirror of the social matter there represented. Their relevance for intercultural competence lies instead in the search for complex meanings, in the fact that they allow us to analyze critically the discourse that guides the logic of identity and the practices that moved and are moved by current and retrospective representations of reality. The development and extension of the processes of mediatization and migration, which characterize globalized modernity, produce a considerable intensification of deterritorialization, understood as a proliferation of translocalized cultural experiences. Deterritorialization implies the growing presence of social forms of contact and involvement which go beyond the limits of a specific territory. Consequently, and since culture is intimately related to the practices, regulations, and values that structure life within a given society, then intercultural competence should also be aware of how those conventions have been influenced and hybridized by different cultures as commonly accepted institutions. Depending on the complexity of those regulations, intercultural awareness may focus on everyday tacit rules, the so-called common sense, as well as on complex political, religious, economic, legal, and philosophical systems. Because all these ideological processes act at the subliminal and at the conscious level alike and contribute comprehensively to the construction and regulation of social identities. Systems of social and cultural regulation offer multiple perspectives for understanding in the present field of intercultural competence. Some possible topics for consideration are the politics of intervention across borders, court interpreting, codes of conduct in social networks, localization of marketing campaigns, power relations in global tourism, immigration and emigration laws, the unspoken rules of gender prejudice, or even the history of the laws of slavery and their power over the fate of millions forcibly displaced along the globe. societies have never been static throughout history, indeed, as they have always adapted and changed according to the stimuli received from other cultures. The main difference is that nowadays, cultural contacts and exchanges occur in a much faster and globalized way. Thus, the centrality of dialogue for a new ethics of the intercultural requires not only respect for other cultures, but also the understanding of how much they already have in common, how they have interacted in the course of time, and how these similarities provide a basis for development of new shared insights. Taking as a paradigmatic case the history of the Portuguese expansion, for instance, it becomes clear that even in a system of cultural dominance, the global interaction provided by the decompartmentalization of the world was made of reciprocal influences. Europeans left their mark in the world, but while interacting with people overseas, they also suffered significant cultural changes. One should note that contemporary Western culture is in itself the result of hybridization under the influence of the so-called minority cultures in a mutual exchange that should not be reduced to mere conflict. The Portuguese role in the making of an early globalized modernity has to be taken into account when the first steps towards full integration of the planet as Old World and New World are brought into systematic conjunction. The creation of a regular globe-spanning network from the early 15th to the later 16th centuries involved the interpenetration of the commercial and the political, the material and the imaginary, the elite and the popular elements of the Portuguese experience. This experience forged particular forms of global consciousness that came to affect not only Europe, but also, through the means of the oceanic networks thus created, much of the rest of the world. Thus, if we are to seek some of the most important precursors of present-day modes of globality and thinking globally, 16th-century Portugal has to be considered. The interactions of Portuguese expansion overseas took place not only throughout the empire, but also at the metropolis back home, because of the way overseas people, their objects, habits, and beliefs merged into Portuguese society, leaving indelible traces in various fields, from visual arts to music, from poetry to myth, from culinary to navigation instruments, from philosophy to natural sciences. Although the crimes of colonial history are obvious, it would be nevertheless relevant to question, albeit carefully and critically, the process of European expansion as a vehicle for the creation of syncretism, with contributions from multiple sources, encompassing similarities and differences where fusions happened alongside segregation. And here we are talking about dialectics and synthesis once again. It comes as a result that the colonial and post-colonial world is a space of constant translation, a permanent contact zone, to quote from Boaventura Sousa Santos. It is a worldwide frontier where peripheral practices and epistemologies are the first to be noticed, though seldom understood. Intercultural encounters and communication, or translation, bring the aspects that each cultural practice believes to be more central or relevant into the contact zone. Therefore, in intercultural contact zones, each culture decides which aspects should be selected for translation, although there are elements which are considered as being untranslatable into other cultures or too vital to being exposed to the perils and doubts of a contact zone. The issue of what should or should not be translated is not limited to the selection criteria each group decides to adapt in the contact zone. Beyond active selectivity, there is something we may call passive selectivity, which consists of what has become unnameable in a given culture due to long-term severe oppression. These are deep-seated silences, absences that cannot be fulfilled but shape the innermost practices and principles of a cultural identity, such as slavery, racism, religious intolerance, colonial oppression, or the subjugation of women, to name but a few. Taking as an example again the Portuguese colonial space, it has often been represented as a mere adjuvant or antagonist in the dominant narrative of the quests for religious conversion, power, wealth, and social promotion. contact zones thus created were never truly hybrid, as everything that did not fit into this great grand narrative had very little meaning for the actors on stage. Similar processes of silencing and production of non-existence have contributed to the construction and strengthening of deep asymmetries between cultures, individuals, societies, and genders, which are characteristic of colonialism and patriarchy. Because cultures are monolithical only when seen from the outside or from a distance. When seen closer or from within, it is easy to understand that cultures are constituted by many and often conflicting versions of themselves. More than ever, intercultural competence is to be practiced both at home and abroad, since their scope may encompass the relations between distant Eastern and Western cultures as much as between marginal and mainstream, youth and senior, rich and poor, erudite and popular cultures in the interior of the same society, which is only apparently cohesive. Still, the need for intercultural understanding among such diversity is often neglected in favor of issues facilitated by distinctive ethnic markers, which in turn evoke the simplistic dichotomy of the archetype white versus black, that is to say, light versus darkness. But then, how to face the deep cultural rifts that exist between generations in a WASP family, for instance? Or the growing gap between rich and poor in the receding Western economics? Or the stereotypes that still underpin the political dialogue between the countries of Northern and Southern Europe? Michael Chapman argues that, unlike in his home country, South Africa, in societies where language, race, religion, class, and comfort are reasonably homogeneous, cultural memory hardly needs to be invoked in the daily round. However, the more homogeneous a society, the easier it is to conceal the manipulation of its cultural memory by the politics of power. Likewise, within the only apparent homogeneity of Portugal, well, if we leave aside the Roma community, which is present throughout the country, or the racial variants that post-colonialism and immigration have recently brought into the major cities only, there are profound cultural differences between urban centers and rural countryside, between coast and inland, north and south, capital and periphery, that, although devoid of visible ethnic markers, require intercultural competence so that dialogue and knowledge may emerge. Only then it is possible to confront the contact zone, the threshold between what we take to be the image of a culture and what is in fact involved in that culture, like the Portuguese or any other. When intercultural competence is put into practice, as we understand it, narratives gradually emerge from a centuries-old silence, narratives that have been straightforward absent from history, to adapt once more the concepts developed by Boaventura de Sousa Santos. Emergent narratives grant a voice to subaltern groups, to all those others history is slowly recognizing. But the narratives of absence are also to be heard as, beyond emergent voices, or maybe through and because of them, it becomes possible to access otherwise silenced narratives of the everyday experience lived in the margins of dominant social structures. These narratives generate a source of vital information that complements official history and is absent from the canon of great narratives with their underlying discourse of power. It is then possible to understand the infinite diversity of human experience, as well as the risk it faces of wasting fundamental experience and knowledge due to the limits and exclusions imposed by strict, isolated areas of knowledge. Here, we may recall again the aforementioned thresholds, border zones, contact zones, and intersected discursive fields. But while borders imply obvious barriers to be challenged, thresholds emerge as subtle intellectual constructions, which, surprisingly or not, are rarely part of the academic institutional routine. They imply access rather than divide, and suggest a potential for making the academic territory more collaborative and intellectually powerful through new processes of identification and interaction. That is to say, through new processes of intercultural competence. once again, and taking into account that communication occurs through multiple, overlapping, and even conflicting discourses. The communication model underlying the concept of interculturalism used here is a palimpsest, a constant intertextuality with other discourses and texts from the past and the present that will, in turn, be used in future discourses and texts as well, in a permanent translation and dialogue between cultures. In this essay, in this conference, we have discussed intercultural competence in some non-traditional perspectives, aiming at the emergence of interstitial spaces that refuse binary representation of cultural antagonism. The discourse of hybrid spaces is based on a dialectic that does not imply cultural hegemony. Instead, hybrid spaces reposition the necessarily partial culture from which they emerge in order to construct a sense of community and a cultural memory that grants narrative power to excluded groups. The condition of the contemporary world, within which the social and cultural multiplicity of the human being has become explicit and visible, both in the streets and through the media, makes the phenomena of diversity ubiquitous and necessarily open to discursive, ethnographic, anthropological, historical, and semiotic analysis, among endless other possible approaches. As a consequence of such diversity, intercultural transits need a map drawn by disciplines that are seldom taken into account in a conservative approach to the notion of culture. This is why intercultural competence should circulate across disciplines, a line of thought which implies hybridization, dynamics, and a permanent challenge to itself. Interculturalism and intercultural competence are epistemological solutions to the political misuse of multiculturalism as a utopian ontology. As a political stance, multiculturalism becomes anchored in a specific, therefore ephemeral, context. Conversely, as an epistemology, interculturalism becomes atemporal and, if transferred in the political arena, likely to function as an effective answer to the essentialism of multiculturalism. Ultimately, if repositioned within alternative academic strategies, it may lead to understanding and reconciliation. Resorting to metaphors to summarize better our point, interculturalism can be seen as the movement of the matter that multiculturalism is. And as there is no static matter in the universe, interculturalism becomes a synonym for the history of humankind, where static, culturally pure societies have never existed actually. Interculturalism is the grammar that connects the worlds of the global text and renders their juxtaposition understandable, communicative, and eventually translatable. Conversely, these words remain orderly but meaninglessly stacked in parallel columns in the dictionary of multiculturalism, which is but a survival toolkit for those lost in a strange culture. As it becomes evident, those who are willing to join the intercultural dialogue must follow new paths across old challenges. This renewed experience implies a dynamic force among cultures and disciplines, and this is the reason why we must question and reposition the motivation, discourses, definitions, strategies, and rules of cultural interaction in their perennial movement. Thank you so much for your attention.
That you might have might be directed to Clara Sarmento direct. We will provide also the email. My dear colleagues, so the plenary session is closed. I invite all of you to some refreshments.